and also about some of the manual part of the neurophysiotherapy right away. Let me wish everyone, every teacher who all are here, a very happy Teacher's Day, or in fact belated happy Teacher's Day, and also Advanced World Physiotherapy Day. So I'll be starting with neurophysiotherapy advancement. There are several advancement has taken place in past. And yes, of course, I'm going to talk more about technology, but then it does not mean that everyone should have complete technology at their disposal also. Definitely people should know, everyone should know that what all things have come up and whether we can have some role to play there. So start with this session. I will just give a brief information about neurophysiotherapy. As you all are understanding, this is a very special branch. Long time back, we started in our institute in year 2000. And then earlier it used to be as elective, now it is a specialization. And you have to understand the people who all are dealing with neurophysiotherapy, they are basically dealing with the conditions which all are concerning with neurological disorders or psychosomatic conditions. And that is why it's a very interesting branch, and it basically deliberating, actually if you see that controlling system of your body. This particular neurophysiotherapy is a section or otherwise a part of neurorehabilitation. I am not saying that it is under neurorehabilitation, but it is definitely a very important part of neurorehabilitation. Neurorehabilitation will be looking after overall a situation of a patient as far as neurological settlement of the patient is concerned, from the hospital to the community. As far as neurophysiotherapy is concerned, the physiotherapist will be basically tackling the issues concerning with the neurological conditions, and they will be again taking the patient back to the community once the patient discharged from the hospital. So in that, the first thing which comes to my mind, which is now playing very good role, is a virtual reality. So virtual reality, when you are saying, it's a very interesting type of therapy. And this is basically utilized for the purpose of training the patient's postural issues and as well as balance issue. So basically it is for improving the posture and balance in the patient. What it is, so it is, you are creating a virtual world. And in the virtual world, you are trying to train the patient, not in connection with the actual world. So that means there are chances of injury, damage, and those things will not be happening. So you are creating a computer-assisted environment. And in this computer-assisted environment, you are simulating the situation with that of outside world. And then you are putting the patient into that outside world, that is virtual world, and allowing the patient to manipulate his or her own body. So when you are talking about the virtual reality, it's having three basic concepts. One is telepresence, teleexistence, and virtual artifact. This is right now, we will not deliberate. We'll deliberate upon, see, this is just the setups I am showing. There are several setups like this. You may be there. You may be seeing this. And if you see the some of the photograph here, the person is riding on a treadmill, and there is certain things that there is a projection in this particular computer, which is giving him some information about the natural world. Here, this is head-mounted device is there. These all are the head-mounted device. These all are basically giving a virtual world to the patient. You see, this is a virtual world created here. And this is what the patient is trying to manipulate. The patient is manipulating by this particular hand gear. Here also, patient is manipulating by hand gear. That means you are trying to treat the patient by means of taking the patient into the virtual world. So where it is applied, what we can train by this virtual reality issues. So we can train any patients. There are certain common conditions of the neurology, like for example, stroke, Parkinson's, ataxia, multiple sclerosis, paraparesis. These are, you name a condition, and most of the condition, there is some role of virtual reality things. And what you can train, what impairment you are going to look for. If the patient is not able to stand, yes, you can be able to train by virtual reality. If the patient is not able to balance, yes, you can be able to train the balance by the means of virtual reality. I cannot show you videos because the time scheduling is very tight, and there are so many things which I am supposed to deliberate. But if somebody is having some question about all this, they can just put it up in the chat box. You can also improve the hand function. You can have the cognitive function, and you can also improve the dual tasking training. So meaning is that you are creating a virtual world, and there the patient has been taken, patient is trained for any of this impairment by different types of gadget or by different types of attachment. So this is one of the development in neurophysiotherapy. If you're thinking that the virtual reality is the only thing which can be tackled, which can be taken up by the neurophysiotherapist, then I have to tell you that the virtual reality can also be utilized for different branches of physiotherapy. But then primarily it will be applied for the neurophysiotherapy patients, persons. We have done one study with this virtual reality. We have a setup of virtual reality. In that, we try to assess about the immediate effect of virtual reality on the balance, gait and posture in stroke patients. And this one was an experimental study. Now this is already published. And what we could find, there was a very good immediate effect. Now you may be thinking, immediate effect means what? Immediate effect means only that the patient could concentrate, patient could try to perform better than earlier. Do not interpret that patient become almost 100% all right because of just giving the virtual reality one session. So it is immediate effect means it is just one session effect. And then if it is one session effect, definitely we can see that the confidence level of the patient improved. And subsequently, when we continued this study for some period of time, we could see that the patient definitely has very good improvement compared to those patients who all were given the conventional type of treatment. So this is one of the things. The second thing is that there is one more concept is coming, and that is of the artificial intelligence. There are so many segments of the artificial intelligence, and I am not going to deliberate each of the section of artificial intelligence, but definitely, yes. What does it mean? It means the thing which you are using, the apparatus or mechanism or the technology which you are using, they will be helping you out, or they will be comparing your performance and the normal performance, and they will try to encourage you doing some certain things which is better than that. So this is a system of ability to correct, interpret the external data, to learn from such data, and to use those learning to achieve the specific goal and task through the flexible adaptation. Now, I'll just give you one simple example for this. Say I am having plenty of patients coming regularly, and they each all are having one single problem, that is they are not able to lift the hand. So what I can do, I can just analyze lifting of hand for each of the person, and I'll put the data into a machine that this is, if the person is not able to do like this, they are having problem with restriction of range of motion, or they are having problem with the muscle strength. So after doing for some of the patient, when the new patient comes, I'll just put the patient into this system, and the system automatically assesses and say that yes, this particular person is having restriction of range of motion, or this particular person having weakness of muscle. So that means I am putting some data and I am getting some response from the machine. Now, if I'm getting some response from the machine, now machine also can suggest how to improve it. And machine will also give some of the things which patient can be able to perform. So this is what is basically a artificial intelligence. Your data compared by the machine data. First data is collected, fed to the machine. Then you are performing. The machine is comparing. And it is saying you are having deficiency here. You try to improve on these aspects. So this is what is a type of artificial intelligence, or you can say the artificial intelligence, which can be utilized in physiotherapy. Now, I am not saying that, yes, tomorrow we should start using this artificial intelligence. I am just suggesting that there are, already we are utilizing some of the section of the artificial, like for example, we are trying to use Balance Master, or we are trying to use gait analysis. Again, I am saying this is not the complete artificial intelligence, but yes, what is there? If I am taking gait analyzer, what gait analyzer does? So gait analyzer tries to analyze, and there are some protocols are there in the gait analyzer. It tries to compare, and if there is a deficiency, it tries to give you a report. Now that means one segment of artificial intelligence is there, but not the complete segment of the artificial intelligence. But just for understanding, this is a part of artificial intelligence which we are using regularly. Consider I developed a ultrasound machine. Now this ultrasound machine, if I just move it on an area whichever is tender, and the ultrasound machine picks up and realizes this is tender, it records it. If if such type of feeling ultrasound is getting, it is tender. Now, after doing for 10-15 patients, the ultrasound will get a clear information. If such texture I am getting, it is a tenderness. So for 12th patient, it will automatically diagnose and try to introduce some part of therapy. So this type of system now gradually coming into picture. So now also, I think you must be using some system of interferential therapy or ultrasound, which automatically says, okay, this program can be used for tendinitis. This program can be used for this. So there is some intelligence. What intelligence? That's suggesting a treatment. But what intelligence is deficient? It cannot detect what is the problem. So you are detecting the problem and they are giving you suggestion. Later on, after some time, they will detect the problem and they will treat the problem. So whatever we are doing, some part of the AI gradually will become a full-fledged AI. Nowadays, world over, in every field, the AI is taken a very important lead or role. There are several studies which has been conducted. I have just quoted here. The natural interaction technology, virtual reality and artificial intelligence for a gait disorder analysis and rehabilitation in the patient with Parkinson's disease. When they did, they say that VR therapy and this artificial intelligence, if they go hand in hand, it will be very better for recovery of the patient. So I have said something about virtual reality. I said something about the artificial intelligence. Now I'm going to tell certain thing about the robotics. Robotics, nothing new. It's a very old concept, in fact. But nowadays, it is coming in new forms. What it is having certain things which is externally fixed, that is on the exoskeleton. And it will have certain things which will be manipulating the whole system of the robots. Now here, when we say robotics, immediately comes to your mind that there is a humanoid or human-like something is there, and that is what is robot. No, that is robot. Robotics is the system which is running the robot. Now, when you are talking about the robotics, so we can make a system which can be utilized for the treatment of the patient. I'll just show you these diagrams. These photographs are being taken from the different places. Now, here you see, this is a robotic arm. Okay. Now there is a program is being fed to this. Now this particular robot is trying to mobilize the limb. Now what benefit is there? The therapist is supposed to initiate the program, fix the part, automatically robot will be keep doing the exercise. So this is one type. There are some more, like for example, if you see, there are robotics which will help the patient in walking. And there are robotics which will help the patient for training of autonomy. So this training technique is really picking up nowadays. Of course, it is not very cost effective, but then for neurological cases, yes, it is very effective. It do have very good outcomes. And that is why this is now gradually picking up and people are using it. So it is a new training technique that involves use of robots. And it is very much effective for hemiplegic and paraplegic. It may also be useful for those who are having paralysis of unknown origin or problems. Then I have not quoted any study here, but then there are some studies in the backside, which I'll be showing you. Then there is one more system called that is known as computer brain interface. So virtual reality is one which we are using. And then after that, robotics is one, and then after that, computer brain interface is there. There are like that. There are several techniques which are now in use in physiotherapy, particularly in neurophysiotherapy. And when you are talking about the computer brain interface, what exactly is happening? It is a direct communication pathway between an enhanced or wired brain and an external device. So that means there is certain things which you are fixing within the brain. Or otherwise, there are certain device which is perceiving the impulses from the brain. So one is that you are putting certain things within the brain, which all are basically picking up the signals and trying to manipulate the thing whichever is outside the body. For example, just by means of getting impulses from the whatever implant is been put up or whatever things you have put up on the skull, with that the person can manipulate things. So when you say brain computer interface, this is from neuromodulation, it allows the bidirectional information flow. That means what you are thinking and what they are performing. So, and then it will be matching with each other. And if they are matching, there is smooth functioning will take place. So a brain computer interface is a computer based system that acquires the brain signals, analyzes them, translate them into command, and are related to the output device to carry out a desired action. So I'll just show you some more diagram for it. Now, if you just see this, this is also what is happening. Signal is coming from here, and there are device which is being placed and is in connection with the brain. Now, this particular device, what it will do, it will process the signal and send it to the external device. And this is the external device. So by this signal, this particular external device will be mobilized. And this is what is an example of brain computer interface. This is also an example of brain computer interface. If you see this particular person, there is certain things is fixed over here. And it is just by her imagination, the thing is been drawn over here. So like that, you see here also, there is certain device is fixed here. It is connected to this computer and to this particular vehicle. So what is happening, whatever C is imagining, it is been interpreted here, and then it is mobilizing this particular system. So that means if the patient is completely disabled, the patient is not able to do anything. In that case, where the patient is not able to also use the mouth for the purpose of other things, like for example, wheelchair training, or for example, anything else, just by imagination or just by stimulating through the brain, the patient can be able to perform some amount of activity. So there are several studies which suggest that yes, brain computer interface do have some role to play. And they have done some studies in stroke and other things. And see, the result is very interesting. It is expected that brain computer interface based rewarding of and MI practice of the early induced improvement in the hand motor outcome, and also this that allows for the limb movements with increased strength and endurance. Its design aims to provide the backup support and sense of user's muscles and sends signal to the motor, which manages the gear. The exoskeleton supports the shoulder, waist, thigh, and assists the movement for lifting and holding the heavy items while lowering back the stress. Now, if you just see this, the whole system is having some control, and they are designed in such a way that the patient can easily be able to stand from sit to stand. It is having inbuilt power, and that is why it will be controlling the patient's ability. And it will help the patient to improve upon their strength and endurance. The other example is bionic hand. Now, some time back, I was talking about brain computer interface, which is more or less like that of brain computer interface only. If you see that, there will be a device which will be attached with the brain, and or otherwise it will be attached with other device at the arm level. The arm will, if the patient is developing a desire to do the movement, the impulse will be generated. It will be perceived by the instrument here, and it will be acted upon, and hence it will be facilitating the muscle to contract. So you imagine, you don't have to have an external stimulator to be put up. There is something which is already working based upon the impulses generated by the brain. And hence the function is being performed. So this is another type of system which is nowadays in use. So There are several things, several different types of thing has come up, and there are several studies also has been done in all these things. And this is one more study, which is basically on exoskeleton. Very interesting, the result suggests that the adoption and integration of bionic exoskeleton. Bionic exoskeleton, whenever we are talking that there is participation of the patient. And if we are saying non-bionics, it will become a pure splint or orthosis. That means where the patient is supposed to put up his or her own effort. Here, patient is supposed to just wear it and use the pain impulses. And that is why it is bionic. So, exoskeleton into the rehabilitation practice is not as simple as training physiotherapist and giving them the device. More research is needed to understand the increased cognitive demand of the working with the patient using technological advances, exoskeleton with a dynamic, technology-rich healthcare environment while managing the patient expectation and ethical issues. So important over here is that, yes, this is a good system, but needs research. You please remember many of the system which I have discussed here, most of them, there are plenty of research is going on. If you are interested, you all also can think of doing some research on this. So there is one more system, that is tele-rehabilitation. Nowadays it is in very much high demand. This is basically based upon the mobile and digital technology. Now tele-rehabilitation, what it does? It uses the information and communication technology as a medium of provision of rehabilitation services to the site or the patient that are distant from the provider. Now, right now, what we are doing, we are giving webinars and all. What we are trying to do, we are trying to take virtual type of information sharing. And this virtual type of information is what we are exactly doing. We are giving information to each other by the, though we are not in contact with each other and we are sitting apart, maybe thousands of kilometers away, but still we are discussing with each other. Nowadays, everywhere, all across the world, because of this pandemic issue, this is one particular thing has come up very interestingly. You can be able to give your advice. You can have your own studio. You should show what a patient is supposed to do. Now, you have to see that, other thing you have to work upon, and then only you are supposed to give. Otherwise, your advice will go free of cost. So you have to work upon it. And if you are working upon it, you can give tele-physiotherapy services. I came to know that many of the metro now tele-physiotherapy services is in process and people are using it. This is one more interesting therapy has come up. This therapy is known as matrix rhythm therapy. First and foremost, I have to make it very clear that this particular therapy is presently very much effectively utilized in few countries, not all the countries, but of course, few countries is very much utilized. It is developed by Dr. Randall, and it is said matrix rhythm therapy. It suggests what? It is having something to do with rhythm. When you are talking about the rhythm, it's something to do with rhythm of the cells, or the cells, if you see that, we normally feel that the cells are in a constant state of rest, but it is not so. The cells are in a continuous state of action, and they are doing certain things, and that is why your body is functioning good. So that is why occasionally there is a problem, and this sensation of activation gradually slows down. And if it slows down, the problem starts and the patient develops some painful conditions also. In such situation, this particular new therapy is very effective, and it causes a very good oscillation. This oscillation is at the range of 8 to 12. It is said that the normal oscillation of the cell also is between this particular range. So if the cell's oscillation reduces and you develop some problem, then this particular therapy helps you to regain the situation. We have used this therapy quite a bit, and we could see that this is very effective for wound healing. This is very effective for arthritic patients. Very, very effective for osteoporotic pains also. Very effective for vascular insufficiency conditions. In fact, I myself had tried for the spasticity, and for spasticity also it was found very effective. And in after one or two session, the spasticity reduces by one grade. But then definitely if you leave it for a long time, for 5-6 days and don't give any therapy, then again comes back to same amount of spasticity. That means if you apply this for a long period of time, it is definitely going to be very effective. We have also used this particular type of therapy for wound healing and migraine patients. And believe it, it definitely has done quite a good work. So I'm not recommending that this should be utilized by everyone, but this is a therapy which can also be a very effective method of treatment for the patients. And as one of the evidence I have just put up here with respect to this particular issues, however, it is still under trial, that is why we are not talking about this particular reference. So this is, there is another one that is transcranial direct current stimulation. This is a type of therapy. I think it is not a new therapy, but yes, we are started using now. So we are saying it is a transcranial direct current stimulation, a very new therapy. Yeah, of course, new for us. It's a form of neuromodulation, and that uses constant low direct current delivered via electrodes on the head. Now, please remember that many times what happens, there is a misconception that it is it should produce very strong contraction to the muscles of the scalp or something like that. But there is no such thing arises with this particular transcranial direct current. It gives a very soothing type of current. And it is very effective for several different types of conditions. And that is why now it is in use. We have seen the studies regarding pain. We have seen the studies regarding rehabilitation of the patient with stroke. So this is also one of the very important thing which has come up. It can be utilized with positive stimulation, that is known as anodal TCDS, and or otherwise it will come with negative stimulation, also known as cathodal TCDS. This is one example of the study. This was done on a stroke patient, and believe it, the result was as suggested. So when they have given a cerebral transcranial direct current, it was found beneficial in improving reaching performance and coordination deficit in the chronic stroke patient. There was significant improvement was seen in different parameters after doing this particular therapy. So this is also one of the very interesting therapy which is nowadays utilized by the patient. This is one thing, as because it is from some company, I am not going to deliberate too much, but this is also one of the very interesting therapy has come up, and very good for patient. Very good means, yes, it is useful for improving the patient's intrinsic hand, and also for certain other part of training. So this is a good therapy tool nowadays in use. And this is one of the example of this particular therapy used for a patient in hemiplegic patient, and what they did, what they got. The study concluded that the training with this particular system becomes more effective when the biofeedback system was applied. And this also demonstrated that by using a biofeedback system, it would be possible for a stroke hemiplegic patient to conduct highly efficient self-rehabilitation ability. So this is what is also one system which has come up in the training and treatment in neuro-rehabilitation or neurophysiotherapy. So all of you must be aware that there are problem in neuro is concerning with motor control. And if you want to develop motor control, there are two ways of developing it. Number one, you can develop by means of training the patient through exercises, or you can train the patient by using isokinetic. So this is what is an isokinetic machine. If in case you are finding that the patient is having issue concerning with knee control, patient is having issue concerning with hip control or ankle control, you can very well recommend the patient to use isokinetic device. I have to make a very clear statement here. If the patient is having very severe spasticity, do not put the patient for this particular system. It is only for the patient who are having functional spasticity, they can be only be trainable in this particular technique. There are several studies done by use of this eccentric resistance training for hip joint in the stroke patient, and they could get very good improvement as far as the outcome measures are concerned. This is one also very interesting technique has come up, and we have worked a lot on this particular technique, that is on mental imagery. And I am sure that every one of you are aware about this mental imagery. And I'll just give you an example of the study which we have done. Many times people say, this is nothing but just imagining. Maybe patient will be imagining something else. So to clear their doubt, there was some study was done. And these are the result of those study. So here if you see, there are two sections they have made. One is perception, another is imagery. That means in normal situation, how the patient is, patient brain is active, and when patient is doing imagery, how the patient brain is active. So if you just compare this, you'll see that there is not much difference. That means mental imagery, if it is properly done, it is just not the imagination of the patient. Yes, it will give the improvement to the patient. We did a study on the handwriting. This is what is the study which we have done. The effect of mental imagery versus mirror box therapy on hand in subacute stroke. Now this very interesting study, what we could see that after doing mental imagery, the patient was giving very good improvement in extremity function. If I remember last time when I was presenting you, I have shown you one video of this where the patient was not able to even touch the glass. After giving 10 days of mental imagery session, the patient was able to grip the glass, patient was able to lift the glass. Same study. I have shown you a video sometime back, I think in last presentation. Now this is what is the another one, that is emotional intelligence. Of course, not a therapeutic issue, but then of course it is very much useful in assessing some part, or it has got certain effect on your treatment protocol. So when you say emotional intelligence is basically the ability to monitor one's own and other people's emotion, to discriminate between different emotion and label them appropriately, and to use emotional information to guide thinking and behavior. Now, why I have put up here for therapy and all, I have put up this here because whenever you are talking about a well-being of a patient or a person, you have to, other than taking care of their physical well-being, you have to see their intellectual well-being, you have to see their spiritual well-being, and you have to see their emotional well-being. So that means you have to see the intelligence, that is intelligence, intellectual ability, you have to see the social intelligence, and you have to see the emotional intelligence. If all three are well set, the patient is set for your treatment. And that is why I have put up this emotional intelligence over here as a new therapy method, because other than other physical therapy part, you also must try to take care of emotional intelligence, because if you take care of emotional intelligence, your part of recovery will be better. So there are so many things in this particular emotional intelligence also. There are several study also has been done in this regard. Other than this, in neurology, there are very good and great role of tapping has come up, and that is why people are using tapping for the purpose of foot drop, for wrist drop, for many other things. Now people have started using tapping, and there are many good effect also is being shown. See, kinesiotropic tapping was done for the stroke patient. One of the studies suggests for upper limb post-stroke spasticity, the patient was being fixed with kinesiotaping, and they could see that the kinesiotaping could provide some benefit in reducing spasticity and in improving the motor performance on the affected hand in the patient with subacute stroke. I don't know, those who all are practicing earlier, if some people are here, then I can say that earlier we used to use the plaster or something like that we used to do for the purpose of maintaining the position after stretching from the spasticity, after stretching the spasticity. But nowadays that looks like a crude method. So simple method has come up, that is kinesiotaping or any that type of tapping. They are definitely going to help the patient for reducing or otherwise controlling the spasticity. Then nowadays, Pilates also is very much is in use for the patients with stroke. Yes, we do use for the particular purpose of, I'm just giving one example, particular purpose of dissociating the different part of the body. Dissociating means we are just trying to reduce the spasticity and getting the pliability of upper limb, lower limb versus trunk. So that is very effective as far as the this one is concerned. Then there is one more thing, that is task specific mirror therapy. I believe all of you are well versed with, but nowadays again it has come back and people are using it very effectively. One more important aspect is gait analyzer. Yes, gait analyzer nowadays is used for two basic purposes. One is for diagnosing or identifying, and second is for basic purpose of assessing the prognosis. I have to tell you one more thing. There is a certain thing that is known as weightless walking, and it is very much now in use everywhere. I have not written it separately, but I was thought of discussing it with the gait analyzer. So when you are talking about the gait analyzer, you are assessing, analyzing, finding out what are the issue in the gait. Then after that, what you are trying to do, you are trying to make the patient to train the gait. Now there are two issues. If the patient is able to walk, we will not use the harness. If the patient is not able to walk, we'll be using weightless walking, where in which we'll be putting the patient on harness and we'll make the patient to walk on the treadmill. And once the patient is been given some training, patient will be brought back to the gait analyzer, and again the analysis will be done. Once analysis is done, we will be able to understand, okay, what all are the shortcomings this particular patient is having. And based upon that, again, we will be modifying our treatment method. This is what is our gait lab. And here, the patient is being asked to move in this particular track. Once the patient moves in this particular track, you get some image, something like that, which will be suggesting about ground reaction force as well as your position when you are walking. So anyway, there is no question I am describing this, but I am just saying so because this is what we are going to do. And then after that, you reanalyze, treat, and again reanalyze. These are all the things are there which will be giving you information about how the patient is walking. What are the impact of the neurological problem to the patient gait has taken place. And based upon that, your treatment strategy will change. So this is a brief presentation from my side. And whatever questions you are having, you can be very well come up. Yes, Dr. Himanshu.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for such a great deliberation on a very good topic. And as neurophysiotherapy and recent advances is really very, very extensive. But it is the expertise of you, sir, that you have concluded and you have finished the talk within such a short period of time and included all the latest trends in the neurophysiotherapy. So really, really hats off to you, sir. And it was really an amazing session as always. And we always learn, love to learn from you. And it is our honor. It is our matter of pleasure that we can hear from you. We can learn from you. And really thankful to you, sir. So today we had a great learning in the all the sessions of the day. Now, I would like to request my own teacher, Dr. Harsh Rajdeep sir, and the founder member of the Team Physio Inculcator, to have some concluding note for the today's one day International Physiotherapy Conference. Harsh sir, please sir. Please unmute yourself, sir. You can.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible. Yes, yes.
Okay, thanks a lot, Dr. Himanshu. My sincere gratitude to Professor Sanjeev Kumar, sir. Sir, it's an outstanding session for learners like us, because a person of your expertise coming to this platform, and that too in the concluding session of this international virtual conference. Nothing can be better than this. So a huge sense of gratitude and gratefulness to you, sir. Thanks, Dr. Himanshu, for giving me this opportunity. I would like to take this opportunity explaining the proceedings of the whole day. We started in the morning 10 a.m. by blessings of Ma Saraswati and the chief guest being Dr. V.P. Gupta, sir, the chief of physiotherapy cardiovascular wing at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Sir gave his inaugural session and then started Dr. explaining the radical history of physiotherapy from the origin to the present era. Then Dr. K. Manai, sir, a very well-renowned person in the field of pulmonary therapy, he narrated on recent advancements on cardiopulmonary physiotherapy, followed by Dr. K. Ganeshan from Coimbatore in sports. He was again followed by Dr. Swapnila Jain, Kuala Lumpur, advanced gynecological physiotherapy. The session just was from Dr. Prakash Shroff from Physio Health Mumbai in orthopedics and manotherapy, and the session, what a learning treat it has been for all of us. We are deeply humbled and overwhelmed with the quality, the content, and with the upgradation what we have achieved in last 6 hours. So a huge sense of gratitude to all the speakers, even of those who are not present here, and to those who are present, especially Professor Sanjeev Kumar, sir, a huge sense of gratitude to you, sir. It has been a journey of around 3 months with the team Physio Inculcators, and as sir said in his narration, that this COVID era has again led to tremendous opportunities, one of them being taking classes and interacting with all through the virtual platform. This Physio Inculcators group was just formed to address knowledge sharing issues, and that too all free knowledge sharing sessions. Till date, this group has conducted more than 100 free knowledge sharing sessions, ranging from simple webinars to the symposium, panel discussions. Yesterday night, we had a Teachers' Day Summit, and today the team was able to successfully accomplish an international conference by the name Physio Inculcators Conclave on the pre-eve of World Physiotherapy Day. So I would like to congratulate all of you for the World Physiotherapy Day. And as we are live with Professor Sanjeev Kumar, sir, belated Happy Teachers' Day, sir, to you also. Sir, thank you, sir. Sir, it is a huge sense of gratitude for all of us. I would like to take the names of the organizing team, because Dr. Himanshu and obviously myself, we are just visible on screen. There is a backstage team working day in and day out. I would like to take the names starting from Dr. Kanchan Sharma, Dr. Ritu Rajdeep, Dr. Meenal Jain, Dr. Shubhangi Sharma, and the moderator for the whole day, Dr. Himanshu Sharma. All have done superb and tremendous work, and not only for this conference, but since last 3 months. And obviously, this has led themselves to be skilled and upgrade more enough. As it is always said that learning is a never-ending process. The capacity to learn is always a gift. The ability to learn is always a skill. And the willingness to learn is obviously a choice. This is in terms of Brian Hubbard, sir. Again, a sense of gratitude to all the people who have attended all these sessions. Today, talking about this, today's international conference virtual session, we had more than 400 attendees and delegates attending the session. And in these late hours of the afternoon, coming to the evening, 4 o'clock also, we had some eight attendees attending this session, ranging from Dr. Jitendra Munjal from Delhi, Dr. Kalpana Joshi from New Delhi, Jamia Hamdard, Dr. Namrata Singh joining from Bhopal, Dr. Jagdish Jaiswal, principal of LN City College of Physiotherapy, Dr. Matthew, Dr. Nanda Kumari, Dr. Ella Jacob, all the way from Malaysia. They all are present in your session, sir. So a huge sense of gratitude to all the attendees. First has been there from Pan India and also from 4 to 5 countries. Thanks to all of you for supporting the initiative of the team, enlightening, gracing the occasion and being there virtually with Professor Sanjeev Kumar, sir. Thanks to all of you. It has been a great day. Thanks, everyone. A sense of humbleness and overwhelmness to everyone.
Sir, 1 minute.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can I say something?
Please, sir. You are most welcome, sir.
Yeah. It was very nice experience. In fact, I think I am at talking to Himanshu almost long time now. Yes, sir. In fact, some faculty also talked in these sessions. It was a very good initiative. I'm sure that you are going to continue this, because is very, very, very effective. And believe me, many people are not aware that what you are doing, what others are doing. So everyone is doing in fragments. So I think we should have little more reach. If we have more reach, I think we can be able to have many more people coming to it. And I am sure that the speaker which you are selecting are really, I think Himanshu knows few of it. I myself have attended, and because of shortage of duration and time, I cannot attend all the things. I have earlier also explained, even in night also 8-9 o'clock, I am little busy. So thank you very much, sir. It was very nice organized, even all the webinars and today's also. I think you are having some more sessions. I don't know, but then it was very nicely organized, sir. Thank you very much for your efforts.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And you had just explained the point which I was about to speak. We will always need the patronage from seniors like you. As you have suggested, that we need to expand our reach. Whatever will be your valuable suggestions and suggestions from all the elite resource persons and speakers, we will definitely try to work on that. Thanks from behalf of Team Physio Inculcators. And in the end, a quote from Mark Ferry. If we are not willing to learn, nobody can help us. But if we are determined to learn, nobody can stop us. So, learning from you, sir, and learning from all the speakers, we need to be humble, we need to be teachable, and we always need teachers like you. Thanks, everyone. Keep learning. Signing off from behalf of Team Physio Inculcators. Thanks to all of you. Surely we'll meet for some other great sessions. Thanks, everyone. Thank you.